Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship this wonderful morning. We need the rain, and the kids are here. We're ready to worship as we enter into Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Let's sing together. Let's stand, congregation, and sing, Hosanna, praise is rising.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. All our fears are washed away, washed away.
Lift those palms high.
Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come and your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you.
Of days.
above and gratefully sing His wonderful love.
Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise.
Amen. What a great way to start off the morning. Let's turn to one another and welcome each other into this space today.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. I'm Amy Holland, the Connection Coordinator. It is so great to see you all here this morning and for those who are joining us online. I hope you did check in on with the iPad on the way in, or you can check in with our online app, or you can fill out the attendance slips and pop them in those offering plates there. I was just going to go over our Holy Week schedule. So we do have a Good Friday service that will be March 29th, so Friday at 6:30. We'll be here in Spirit Hall. We hope you can join us for that. And then our Easter Sunday services will be at the same time, 9 and 10:30. But we are also having an Easter egg hunt next weekend, so Saturday. It's going to be at 10 o'clock. We're going to meet in here first in Spirit Hall. We're going to have some treats and some coffee, and then we'll kind of get lined up for our groups, and then we'll go outside for the Easter egg hunts, and hopefully the weather will be okay. We'll see. I'm not allowed to look yet, so. And then if you want to come back in, we will have the Easter Bunny here too for a photo opportunity. So that will be fun also. But that's just a little bit what's coming up for this next week. And now it is time for our centering song.
We sing In Christ Alone.
Till on that cross, as Jesus died,
me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny.
My name is Joshua, and as is customary in Lent, I am bringing the prayer of confession and then our prayers. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ,
you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us pray. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. God, even though we know how this chapter of the story ends, let me not skip ahead to Easter Sunday. In these coming days, you showed us your humanity. You show us the best of us and the worst of us. God, I am the palm branch waver, and I am the soldier approaching the garden. I'm the crowd chanting for your death, and I am the one whose feet you washed. I am Peter, swearing never to leave your side, and I am the disciple who falls asleep to what you call me to do and be in our world. As we enter this week, God, I ask for strength, love, and humility for myself, for our church family, for our musicians and those preparing our times of worship this week, and for our brothers and sisters throughout the world who openly or in hiding are preparing the way for you, Lord. As we approach the time of speaking the Lord's Prayer, let us remember that even in the foreshadow of death in the garden and with great agony, you speak similar words, not my will, but yours. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Sandy. Our reading this morning is from the Gospel of Mark. Jesus and his disciples came to a place called Gethsemane. Jesus said to them, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him. He began to feel despair and felt anxious. He said to them, "I'm very sad. It's as if I am dying. Stay here and keep alert." Then he went a short distance farther and fell to the ground. He prayed that, if possible, he might be spared this time of suffering. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping. He said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Couldn't you stay alert for 1 hour? Stay alert and pray so that you won't give in to temptation. The spirit is eager, but the flesh is weak." Again, he left them and prayed, repeating the same words. And again, when he came back, he found them sleeping, for they couldn't keep their eyes open, and they didn't know how to respond to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Will you sleep and rest all night? That's enough. The time has come for the human one to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let's go. Look, here comes my betrayer." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Jeff Slater, lead pastor here at Trinity. It is good to see you all and to be worshiping with you all this morning. I made a joke downstairs with the pancakes earlier this morning that the whole church was going to have a food coma during the sermon. And I had forgotten at the time just how much of our scripture today is about disciples going to sleep. So if anybody needs coffee, there's plenty. Now, Jesus said, "I came so that they may have life and have it to the fullest." And that kind of life is what we are drawn to here at Trinity. Our vision is to build a community of people who are fully alive in Christ because we're drawn to it in one another, and others are drawn to it in us. It's the life of Christ in us, and it's these moments like these that help shape and help form that in us. So I'm glad you all are here to be part of it today. As always, there's a place in the bulletin to jot down a few notes. I've long given up the idea that you'll hear anything I say, but it's amazing how often God says something, and something, a random thought might occur to you during moments like these that is exactly what you need to hear, and if you write it down, you'll hang on to it longer. So I would draw your attention to that. All right, I'm going to sing a prayer for myself. If you know it, you're welcome to join me. Let us pray. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, And that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Amen. Well, here we are. The 8 days that are at the heart of Christianity. We begin, of course, today with the waving of palms and remembering Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem, which has so many layers of meanings. It goes back to the prophets in the Old Testament in the Hebrew Bible. It was mocking the tradition of Rome of the day, of having a triumphal entry of soldiers. Instead of riding in on a war horse, he rides in on a donkey. And at the same time, it is, of course, highly symbolic of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem and arrival where the temple is, and sets into motion all the events that are soon to follow. We remember in a week like this just how quickly the crowd went from shouting Hosanna to shouting Crucify Him. That it was likely many of the same people that shouted both, even in the same, practically even the same moment, or at least very close to it. Now, next Sunday, we'll celebrate how Jesus not only overcame the evils of the world, but used them to transform everything, including us. But first, we walk the journey with him, and we remember that story. You know, it doesn't matter how many times it happens. You know, back before I was a pastor, just reading the Bible, every time I would get to this section, it just takes on a new layer of meaning. And I've been a pastor for, I think this is my 20th year of being a pastor, something like that. And every year, it just draws me in and is amazing what this story does. Now, this year, we are doing a read-through of the Gospel of Mark as a church. If you've been around for the whole season of Lent, you know that we passed out these bookmarks. In fact, you can still get one. This is, in fact, the most important part, so it's not too late to start. But we've been reading through the Gospel of Mark each day, and when you're steeped in those stories, when you're immersed in them, when you have that context of Jesus growing up, of his life as a teacher, of Jesus' strong moments, of his weak moments, and it all comes together in that kind of context that surrounds the story of Holy Week, it means even more. And in fact, if any of you want bonus points — God doesn't really work on points, but hey, why not? If any of you want bonus points, the Gospel of Mark is the shortest gospel, and if you wanted to sit down this week and start back over at the beginning and read through, you could easily do it in one sitting. And I would invite you to do that, because it will make it even more poignant as we go through. But this morning, I thought we would read a little bit of it together, and I'll fill in a few blanks and comments as we go. But let's start with the Passover meal in Mark chapter 14. So this is actually the story of Maundy Thursday. However, we're doing a Good Friday service this year, but not a Maundy Thursday one, so I thought it would be good to remind us of the story. So Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples, went to the chief priests to give Jesus up to them. When they heard it, they, the chief of priests, were delighted and promised to give him money. So he started looking for an opportunity to turn him in. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed — now remember, this is one of the holiest weeks in Judaism, and so this is the closest comparison to us would be Christmas, when the whole world shuts down and everybody's family traditions kick in, and we have Christmas Eve service and family traditions all around it too, and all that. This is what that time was like. And here Jesus and his disciples are traveling in a city that they don't live in, and so they need a place to have their Passover meal. So his disciples said to him, to Jesus, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover meal?" He sent two of his disciples and said, "Go into the city. A man carrying a water jar will meet you. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs already furnished." If any of you use the United Methodist devotional book, Upper Room, we have them on the counter out there. This is where the name comes from. The disciples left, came into the city, and found everything just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. That evening, Jesus arrived with the 12. During the meal, Jesus said, "I assure you that one of you will betray me, someone eating with me." Deeply saddened, they asked him one by one, "It's not me, is it?" Now, is it interesting to anybody else that all of the disciples, all 12 of them, had a little inkling in their heart that it might be them? They all knew that they were capable of that kind of deception. At least that's what I read in there. But as they went around saying, "It's not me, is it?" Jesus answered, "It's one of the 12, one who is dipping his bread with me into this bowl. The human one goes to his death, just as it is written about him. But how terrible is it for that person who betrays the human one? It would have been better for him never to have been born." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave them to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." He took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. I assure you that I won't drink wine again until that day when I drink it in a new way in God's kingdom." After singing songs of praise, they went out for the Mount of Olives. Now, you all know that whenever we have communion, what we're doing is we're reenacting this. And the tradition of it goes back further than just Jesus. This is the Passover tradition, which goes back thousands of years from now, that Jesus took and helped everybody to see in a new way. Whenever we take the bread and the cup, we remember this meal and we remember Jesus' sacrifice. All right, so they go to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus says to them, "You will all falter in your faithfulness to me." Now, you remember what he said earlier? He said, "One of you will betray me," knowing what Judas had done and knowing what was to come. But in this moment, he doesn't say, "One of you will falter." He says, "All of you will falter in your faithfulness to me. It is written," and this is a quote, "I will hit the shepherd and the sheep will go off in all directions. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even if everyone else stumbles, I won't." In other words, my faith isn't going to falter, Jesus. We've been through so much together. I'm not going to betray you. Absolutely not. But Jesus said to him, "I assure you that on this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." But Peter insisted, "If I must die alongside you, I won't deny you." And they all said the same thing. Spoiler alert, he does. Jesus and his disciples came to a place called Gethsemane. Jesus said to them, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John along with him. He began to feel despair and was anxious. He said to them, "I'm very sad. It's as if I'm dying. Stay here and keep alert." Then Jesus went a short distance further and fell to the ground. He prayed that, if possible, he might be spared the time of suffering. He said, "Abba." Abba, by the way, is the word for God that is most endearing. Sometimes people compare it to daddy. I don't think that's quite right, but it is a very familiar, a very loving, almost childlike form of father. So he says, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not what I want, but what you want." Now, this is such an amazing scripture. If you were here when we had the doubt series, this scripture is relevant both to suffering and also to unanswered prayer, because this is perhaps Jesus' most prominent unanswered prayer, when he cries out to God, "God, don't make me go through this." And of course, out of his faith, he does add, "Not what I want, but what you want." But it's obvious that he doesn't want to. There he is, facing fear. And whenever we face fears of our own, whenever we face sufferings of our own, we can look to this moment to know that we have a God who knows very much what we're going through. Well, he comes out from that moment back to his disciples. You know, he'd been away on his own a little bit. He comes back and he finds them sleeping. He said to Peter, "Simon," his other name, "are you asleep? Couldn't you stay alert for 1 hour? Stay alert and pray so that you won't give in to temptation. The spirit is eager, but the flesh is weak." Again, he left them and prayed, repeating the same words. And again, when he came back, he found them sleeping, for they couldn't keep their eyes open, and they didn't know how to respond to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Will you sleep and rest all night? Here is Jesus in his hour of most need, when he is at his weakest." Now, don't think his weakest moment was on the cross. It wasn't. In fact, that was a moment of true strength. But in this moment, when he is at his weakest, already his disciples are faltering. And he says to them, "Will you sleep and rest all night? That's enough. The time has come for the human one to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let's go. Look, here comes my betrayer." You know what strikes me about this story this year? Humility. Now, most people have the wrong idea about humility and what it means. You know, usually when we use the word humility, we talk about making someone feel small. You know, especially if we use another form of the word, humiliation. We usually mean by it making someone small. But that's not really what the word humility means. Technically, the word humility means having an accurate view of yourself. Now, to be honest, for most of us, that means we need knocked down a peg or three because we think too much of ourselves. And that's where we get the common use of the word humiliation. But the word also means that if you think too low of yourself, that you need to be raised up to where you are. Humility does not mean feeling worthless, or at least it shouldn't mean that. It means having an accurate view of who you are. And in fact, both can be true. I'm a believer that a great many of us actually think too little of ourselves, and we compensate for it by being overconfident. So we present ourselves to the world and act like we're all that, when in truth, we know just how little we are. And if anything, we need to be affirmed of our worth so that we don't have to overcompensate in how we act. You see, both can be true. True humility is knowing that you are small. It's knowing who you are in comparison to God and the universe, but also knowing that that God loves you, has created you with great worth, and will be with you to the end. Both can be true at once. And in fact, we see it in Jesus. I mean, we see it so powerfully in these stories that Jesus is small, especially in the Garden of Gethsemane, in his moment of weakness, praying, "God, please don't make me do this. If there's any other way, please do it." And yet, he still knows who he is. He still knows who his role is. He stands tall even when he allows himself to be weak. You know, I really do think that there is nothing more important in life, and certainly in Christianity, than true humility. You know, I mentioned the doubt series earlier. That's what embracing our doubts is all about. It's admitting that we don't know everything. It's admitting that we aren't all that, but that God wants to show us and wants to help us to grow. It's knowing that we can be both weak and strong by the grace of God at the same time. Everything in life requires great humility. Anything worth doing in life requires great humility anyway. And it is all over the story of Holy Week. In fact, you'll find it, I think, in every single story. You know, we started this series of reading through the Gospel of Mark for Lent with the idea of the lens. You remember the whole phoropter thing? I'm not going to go through all that again. If any of you missed it, you can catch it up. But we talked about how important it is to look at life through the lens of Jesus, and one of the reasons we're reading through Mark is so that we can spend some time looking through that lens at the world. Well, I want to expand that metaphor a bit further today to the idea of color. You know, daylight is a bit blue, right? Maybe not today. That's kind of gray. But sunsets tend to be more red. And sleep experts are beginning to realize that red light of sunset helps our body produce melatonin and helps us sleep so that the color of the light around us matters. Theater folks know that the colors that they put on the stage can change the mood and can change everything. Well, I would suggest that Lent, especially Holy Week, is a color that we look through that shapes us and that shapes the thing we do in the world around us. Have you ever noticed or seen an old letter, perhaps recorded in a book or reading something historic, and at the end of the letter, the person who writes it signs their name and then they write where they are in the church year? Have you ever seen that before? Like they might write a letter and say, you know, Jeff Slater, Wednesday of Holy Week, or something like that. That's an old tradition to write that into letters. Have you ever wondered why? Well, there may be reasons that even I don't know about, but one reason is because it changes how we speak. It changes how we think. It casts a color on the words that are in that letter. A letter that is written to you on Good Friday is probably going to have a different tone than a letter that's written to you on Easter Sunday, right? And it helps to know that. So here's my challenge to you this week. Let this story color your world. Let it color your words and your actions. Let your words be different because of Holy Week and because of the scriptures you read each day if you're following along. Let your thinking be different in light of Jesus' journey to cross. Let your attitude rise and fall along with that of the disciples, even in this week where it is the most difficult to do. And find that all of it makes you more humble. But remember, being humble is not just feeling low. It means both knowing that you are small, but by the same story, knowing that you are worth it. But, and this may be the most important thing of all, let the story color your life this week, but don't let it end this week. At least follow through to next Sunday. Because the truly humbling, awe-inspiring, life-affirming, world-transforming part of the story is just around the corner. And the color of the light that comes at the end changes everything. Let us pray. Oh God, thank you for your gospel. Thank you for your story, through which you teach us so much of your heart and through which you show us so much of your love. Help us to enter into the story this week. May it color our lives. And when next Sunday comes, may we emerge into the light of the empty tomb as ones who know both their smallness and their true worth in you. We pray it in the name of the one whose story we follow. Amen. All right, we move now to the time of our service for gratitude and generosity. And I want to say thank you for all of you who make Trinity what it is. Your very presence here this morning in person, or those of you joining us online, your presence is worth a great deal. But thank you for your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness. All of it helps make Trinity what it is. And a special thank you to all of the youth and parents and volunteers and who knows who else who helps make things like our pancake feed possible. Of course, it does take financial gifts to keep things going, and it's much appreciated, all of you who give sacrificially. You are most welcome to do so this morning. You'll find offering plates on your way out, or you can give on our website at trinitylincoln.org. For our mission moment today, though, we have something special, and actually, it's a mini commissioning service. Many of you have heard of Justice in Action, the community organization that our church helped found, along with 20-some other churches in town. And in fact, it continues growing. This is the second year through the cycle of things. Together, we have adopted three focuses in our community of things that we want to make better. We're focusing on diversion programs to help keep people out of jail. Mental health, we've realized that a navigator system would be easy to do and would greatly benefit our community. And now we've added affordable housing as a third focus. You know, all of this comes from our faith, because it's one thing to help the poor, but you can't do that without asking why there are so many that need the help, and this is our answer to it. Now, we're going to have a big rally on May the 2nd, a Nehemiah rally it's called, and we need as many people as possible there to help make a splash, to help make it an event, to help draw more attention to it too. So, all of our network members in our church are about to make phone calls to the people of our church to invite them personally to the Nehemiah rally on May the 2nd. If you are one of the network members, would you stand up? Because I want to say a prayer. Many of them are probably also volunteering with other things. All right, let's say a prayer. Oh God, thank you for the opportunity that we have to make our world look more like your kingdom. Please bless our network members as they invite all of us to this rally that is to come. And please help all of us to listen to your call as we receive those invitations. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, look for their calls, and when they call you, please say yes, because we need as many people possible at that rally to help make a splash, as I say. But for now, we take all of the gifts that we offer and all of the things that we do and symbolically lay them on the altar, along with the gift of music.
Jesus walked this lonesome valley. We must
We got some blues fans here at Trinity. That was awesome. All right. So as you leave, don't forget to fill a bag for the students at some of the students at Hill Elementary. Let's see if I can get this right. So Friday we have a service at 6:30, a Good Friday service. Of course, in person. If you can't make it in person or it's difficult, you can join online, or if you're working, even you can watch it later, as we'll have it on our website. That's Friday at 6:30. Saturday morning we will have the Easter egg hunt along with the inside component, which I think will make it good. So I hope all of you are here for that. And then, of course, next Sunday is Easter, which you absolutely will not want to miss. But for now, would you please rise for the benediction? May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Amen.
We sing our closing song, "We Will Glorify the King of Kings."